and rats racing against time for students in pathology shall continue. I got a couple of questions for you people, which are regularly asked but difficult to handle. The first one shall be the cystic diseases of the kidney. And this is the importance in multiple subjects, not only in pathology. What is the definition of a cyst? A cyst is a distended space that is lined by an intact epithelium. Whereas a pseudocyst has got no definite epithelial lining. This is more common in the region of the pancreas. And in this picture, we shall be seeing the normal kidney with the corticomedullary differentiation and the calyces, the ureter, and the renal pelvis. Whereas in this one, I am finding multiple spherical bubble-like structures throughout the parenchyma. And externally also, I could see that there is an uneven surface. So this is a case of a polycystic kidney. How do you classify the cystic lesions of the kidney? In fact, I recollect that one student, this was the only question that I had asked. There was a specimen of a polycystic kidney and I asked her what the cystic diseases were and she rattled off. It can be a polycystic kidney, either the autosomal dominant or the autosomal recessive. A medullary cystic disease, which can be a medullary sponge kidney or a nephronephthosis. Multicystic renal dysplasia. And in some cases, we find dialysis patients also go in for a cystic disease. There is a cyst called the simple cyst, and hereditary malformations can also result in this. Glomerular cystic disease and extraparenchymal renal cyst. So these are the cystic lesions. I would like you people to kindly memorize this. Two basic things we shall be remembering. One is the adult polycystic kidney and the other is an infantile polycystic kidney. I would also like you to kindly draw this diagram. In the adult polycystic kidney, I am finding multiple cystic spaces externally and it will be having an uneven, bosselated surface. Whereas in an infantile or a childhood polycystic kidney, you find that the external surface is smooth, but on cutting it open, there will be radially arranged numerous cystic lesions. These two fundamentals we shall be remembering and we'll go into the details. There are two types. Now, one is autosomal dominant or the adult and the recessive. Remember this, AD, adult is equal to autosomal dominant. In this condition, you find that there is a cyst formation and it results in multiple cystic lesions of the kidney. And this is a diagrammatic representation of the glomerulus and the tubules. After all, where do we get the cystic lesions from? It is from the tubules. It can be the descending, the loop of Henle, the ascending, or the collecting duct. And because of this, there will be some differences which I shall mention later on. Whereas in the case of an infantile or a recessive polycystic kidney disease, it is mostly restricted to the collecting duct. Adult polycystic kidney disease, a university question and a specimen. It is seen in 1 in 1,000 individuals, an autosomal dominant, and it has got 100% penetrance. The greater the age of the individual, more chances for him to develop the polycystic kidney disease. It is associated with a defect in the alpha globin gene in chromosome number 16. And it is otherwise called the PKD gene 1, polycystic kidney disease gene 1. It is generally bilateral, and initially you find that the renal function is bad. But later on, the patient will develop a hypertension or a renal failure. And this is the origin of the cyst. Cysts arise from the tubules throughout the nephron. And there will be a variable lining because the different sites of the nephron will be having different lining. And this is the development. So initially you find that there is a normal kidney, but then with the abnormality of the gene, you find that there can be polycystic lesions developing and the kidney gets enlarged. Sometimes it can be massively enlarged that it almost fills the entire jar. And I'm finding multiple lesions. Grossly, it is a massively enlarged kidney. The corticomedullary differentiation cannot be made out. The pelvic LCL system is also distorted, and it can weigh up to 4 kg. There are multiple cystic spaces. Some of them are very small. Some can be very large, up to 4 centimeters in diameter. Each of these cysts can be either transparent or it can be hemorrhagic. And it is filled with a clear or a hemorrhagic fluid. Thin-walled with the loss of the parenchyma, and there will be slender septae which are separating the cystic lesions. The clinical manifestations will be pain, hemorrhage. Hematuria is one of the common complications of polycystic kidney. Renal colic. A dragging sensation can be because of the large mass, the increase in the weight. Proteinuria and hypertension. Finally, the patient can go in for a renal failure. So these will be the manifestations. As we always used to say, once there is a cystic lesion or a congenital lesion, look for lesions elsewhere. The patient can be having polycystic liver disease, or it can be a cystic disease of the spleen, lung, and the pancreas. In the brain, there can be a perianeurysm. And what are all the diagnostic indicators? One will be a CT scan, an ultrasound, azotemia, something like proteinuria, and there can be the other complications which also will help us in assessing the condition. The next one is the infantile polycystic kidney. It occurs in infancy or in slightly older child. Autosomal recessive in nature. So it is perinatal, neonatal, infantile, or juvenile. And here also, the patient can succumb to renal failure. I would like you to kindly appreciate this picture. I am tracing the external contour of the kidney. It is smooth. And the cut surface, here also, the corticomedullary differentiation is getting lost, but then the cystic spaces are predominantly radially spaced. And when these are cut across, I can see small cystic lesions. They are there. And secondly, it involves the entire cut surface. The kidneys are enlarged, smooth, it is bilateral. There is a mutation of the gene in chromosome 6. Multiple cystic spaces can be seen, and it is more or less like a sponge. So sponge-like. Elongated channels which are perpendicular to the cortex. And there is a cylindrical dilatation of the tubules. Please read this up. This is important. So it can be associated with congenital hepatic fibrosis, portal hypertension, and the polycystic kidney of the disease. These go hand in hand. And microscopically, there is a cylindrical dilatation of the collecting tubules, which are lined by uniform cuboidal cells. The patient can also have cystic disease of the liver, and there is a portal bile duct proliferation. So these are all the microscopic features, and these are the clinical manifestations. Now, how does a cyst develop? So this is a diagram of a normal tubule. Now, what will happen is whenever there is going to be an obstruction, you find that the fluid cannot be leaving, and hence there will be a dilatation of the tubule. That is one. Secondly, there can be a weakness in the basement membrane, and that will also lead to distension. Third one will be there is a proliferation of the cells, and these cells can lead to increase in the weight and dilatation. So this pathogenesis, I would like you people to kindly mention. This particular diagram you can draw, especially these two, the distinction between the adult and the infantile polycystic kidney. This is the pathogenesis that I meant in the last step. You find that there is a clone of cell that undergoes increased amount of proliferation. And when there is a multiplication, there is an increase in the weight, and it tends to balloon out, forming a cystic disease. So the mechanism, it goes like this. Weakness of the basement membrane, there can be obstruction or pressure, and third one, there can be proliferation of the epithelium. Any of these or all of these can lead to cystic disease of the kidney. This is a simple cyst which can be found in the cortex, usually solitary and small, but it can be large. And it is glistening, lined by a single layer of cuboidal or flattened epithelium. Not very significant. Most of the cases are incidental findings. And this is a specimen of a medullary sponge kidney. Adult in onset of unknown pathogenesis. And you find that the papillary ducts in the medulla are dilated. This is the cortex outside and this is the medulla. And microscopically, they are lined by cuboidal or transitional epithelium. I would like you people to spend some time and find out the differences between the two, because these can be kept as specimens for the viva. And when you compare, you'll be able to remember. Please recollect the differences between the two. And this again is a tabular column derived from Robbins. It gives a summary of all the cystic diseases. I would like you people to kindly go through. And these line diagrams are also worth drawing. So what are all the different cystic diseases? What is the mode of inheritance, the pathological features, and what are the complications and the clinical features, ultimate outcome, and a diagram. This will help you in recollecting it, but then go through the theory given earlier. A fantastic diagram that I had taken from this reference. So here I find that there are multiple cystic lesions and of varying sizes, translucent. Some of them are slightly hemorrhagic and separated by a thin rim of parenchyma, which is totally atrophic. Another question for the day will be the transitional cell carcinoma or the urothelial carcinoma. And this again, not an essay usually, it is asked as a short essay. Sometimes it can be a clinical case in your subjects, multiple choice questions, viva versi. Usually it is asked as a short note. 90% of the cases occur in the bladder, but it can also be seen in the ureter as well as in the renal pelvis and in the cervix. There are also other tumors that can occur in the bladder, and the paramount important one will be the squamous cell carcinoma, and the second one is adenocarcinoma. So three tumors we shall remember: transitional cell carcinoma, squamous cell carcinoma, and adenocarcinoma. So this is the reference for this diagram, and you find that in one, this is a bladder wall. So it is composed of two layers of the muscle. There is a connective tissue in between, and externally there can be a serous. In one, there is a papillary tumor. In another, it is flat, and it is infiltrating down. In the third one, it is limited to the epithelium, and this is called as a carcinoma in situ. So three patterns are there, kindly remember. This we shall see, be seeing repeatedly. Now, what are the causes for the bladder cancer? One is cigarette smoking, anilin dyes of the petroleum industry. Urinary calculi, they can lead to repeated irritation and then development of a malignancy. Drugs such as cyclophosphamide, radiation, catheterization, and schistosomiasis, it can lead to a squamous cell carcinoma and overexpression of the RAS oncogene or EDGF. Any of these can be the causes. See, strangely, cigarette smoking is not only causing lung cancer, but it is also causing a bladder cancer. And anilin dyes will be of great importance. This is a gross picture of an opened out bladder. I used to tell you people, bag-like structure, think of only two. One is a stomach and another is a urinary bladder. And there is a large, friable, grayish white growth, and it is showing some areas of congestion and hemorrhage. It is very friable. Even the picture, if you touch it, it will peel off. Whereas the bladder wall is strong. It can be unicentric or multicentric, and sometimes it can be large. And this is a picture of the schistosomia hematobium. And it's a tapeworm, and the ova can be seen. Here again, there is a kind of an irritation that can lead to a malignant transformation. This is important, and it is also a fluke that is asked as an essay question for you in parasitology. Please remember these things. It can be unicentric or multicentric, and it can be papillary, nodular, or flat. The normal color is pinkish gray. You are seeing it over here. It can be 1 to 5 centimeters or larger. Sometimes it can fill the entire bladder, as we have seen in this picture. Usually the region of the trigone of the bladder is commonly involved, but it can occur on the lateral sides also. And when it obstructs the ureteric orifice, it leads to hydroureter. Hydronephrosis later on, and when there is a stasis, it can lead to pyelonephritis. Please remember these things, you shall and will write it. This is a cross section of the bladder, a diagrammatic representation showing the various stages and the development. It can be either flat, a carcinoma in situ, or it can be a papillary type of a carcinoma, or it can be infiltrating. In this case, it is flat and infiltrating. Here it is elevated and infiltrating. And later on, you find that the adjoining structures can also be involved, including the bony pelvis. Extend onto the prostatic gland and the urethra. Please remember the schematic diagram. It is beautiful for you people to follow it. Not necessarily to be drawn, but for you to follow. And this is a New England Journal of Medicine. And cystoscopy is putting in an endoscope into the bladder. I find that there is a tumor, very fine, and almost like a sea anemone. And where is the sea? The urine is the sea. And you find that these delicate fibrils keep moving around, just like a sea anemone. Almost analogous to it. I think both the pictures are fantastic, and the credit is worth to me. This diagram we people shall be drawing. So there is a papillary carcinoma, finger-like projection, which is branching and rebranching. And here there is a papillary, but at the same time it is infiltrating. In this case, it is flat and limited to the epithelium, whereas in another one, it is flat, but it is invading the muscular layer. This is a beautiful diagram, again from Robbins. I think you people can draw it. A papillary carcinoma, invasive papillary carcinoma, a flat non-invasive carcinoma, and a flat invasive carcinoma. Punlump is an in situ tumor, papillary urothelial neoplasm of unknown malignant potential. There is a papillary carcinoma which can be non-invasive and invasive. clot which can again be divided into non-invasive and invasive. Please remember this one. This will fetch you marks. And this can be a slide for us also. As we had mentioned earlier, finger-like projections, which are branching and rebranching. And there will be a central fibrovascular core. I am seeing a very slender line that is a fibrovascular core. And all these dark blue dots are the nuclei. Count the number of nuclei that will be indicating the number of layers of the epithelium. This is a transitional epithelial tumor. And when it is less than 5, it is supposed to be almost benign. Up to 7 is grade 1. Then up to 10 or even more. What are all the differences? We shall be seeing. Again, papillary projection, fibrovascular core, and the transitional epithelium. This is a higher magnification, and I find these are all the cross surfaces of the blood vessels, a fibrovascular core, and these are all the epithelial cells. I can count the number of nuclei in one vertical line. But here I find that they are haphazardly arranged. This is called as loss of polarity. Mitotic figures can be present. There can be mild to moderate pleomorphism and sometimes differentiation. What is the meaning of the word differentiation? Resembling the cell of origin. Sometimes it will not resemble at all. It is supposed to be poorly differentiated. And this is what we had seen earlier. The method of diagnosis will be cystoscopy, surgical excision, and treatment will be chemotherapy by vincristine and cyclophosphamide. Sometimes an entire bladder can be removed. So these are the methods of diagnosis and treatment. Blagadatyo Vas.